have substantial evidence. He was washing Patsy Hampton's blood off himself in the bathroom. There's residue in the sink. Coleman nodded and shrank back into his easy chair. I don't understand why Jules Halpern is involved. I'm sure we'll know before too long, though. I'm afraid we'll know soon, I said. I decided to leave the station by the back way that night, just in case there was press lying in wait out in front on Alabama Avenue. As I stepped outside, a small, balding man in a light green suit popped out from behind the adjacent stone wall. That's a good way to get yourself shot, I told him. I was only half kidding. Occupational hazard, he lisped. Don't shoot the messenger, detective. He smiled thinly as he handed me a white letter-sized envelope. Alex Croth, you've hereby been served with a summons and complaint. Have a nice night, detective, he said in his sibilant whine. Then he walked away as surreptitiously as he appeared. I opened the envelope and quickly scanned the letter. I groaned. Now I knew why Jules Halpern had been retained and what we were up against. I had been named in a civil suit for false arrest and defamation of character of Colonel Jeffrey Schaefer. The suit was for $50 million. The next morning I was summoned to the District of Columbia Law Department offices downtown. This was not good, I decided. The city's chief counsel, James Dowd, and Mike Kersey from the DA's office were already ensconced in red leather club chairs. So was Chief of Detectives Pittman, who was putting on quite a show from his front row seat.
You mean to tell me that because Schaefer has diplomatic immunity, he can avoid criminal prosecution in criminal court? But he can traipse right into our civil court and get protection against false arrest and defamation?
Kersey nodded and made clucking noises with his tongue and teeth.
Yes, sirree, Bob. That's it exactly. Our ambassadors and their staffs enjoy the same kind of immunity in England and everywhere else around the world. No amount of political pressure will get the Brits to waive immunity.
Schaefer is a war hero from the Falklands. Supposedly, he's also pretty well respected inside the security service, though lately he seems to have been in some trouble.
What kind of trouble, I asked. They won't tell us. The phone on Dowd's desk rang, and he raised his hand for quiet. That's probably Jules Halpern. He said he'd call at 10, and he's an efficient bastard. If it is him, I'll put him on the speaker box. This should be about as interesting as a rectal exam done with a cactus. Dowd picked up and exchanged pleasantries with the defense attorney for about 30 seconds. Then Halpern cut him off. I believe we have matters of substance to discuss. My schedule is rather tight today, and I'm sure you're rather hard-pressed as well, Mr. Dowd.
Yes. Let's get down to business, Dowd said, raising his thick, curly black eyebrows.
As you know, the police have a qualified privilege to arrest anyone if they have probable cause. You simply don't have a civil case, Counselor.
Halpern interrupted Dowd before he had finished speaking. Not if that person identifies himself from the outset as having diplomatic immunity, which my client did. Colonel Schaefer stood in the doorway of his therapist's apartment, waving his British Security Service shield like a stop sign, and saying that he had immunity.
Dowd sighed loudly into the phone. There was blood on his trousers, Counselor. He's a murderer, Counselor, and a cop killer. I don't think I need to say any more on the subject. With respect to the alleged defamation, the police also have a qualified privilege to talk to the press when a crime has been committed.
And I suppose that the chief of detectives' statement in front of the reporters and several hundred million others around the world isn't slander per se.
That's correct. It isn't.
There's a qualified privilege with respect to public figures such as your client.
My client is not a public figure, Mr. Dowd. He is a very private individual. He is an intelligence agent. His very livelihood, if not his life, depends on his being able to work undercover.
The chief counsel was already exasperated, possibly because Halpern's responses were so calm, yet always delivered rapid fire.
All right, Mr. Halpern. So why are you calling us?
Halpern paused long enough to make Dowd curious. Then he began again. My client has authorized me to make a very unusual offer. I have strongly advised him against it, but he maintains his right to do so.
Dowd looked startled. I could tell that he hadn't been expecting any kind of deal offer. Neither had I. What was this about?
Go ahead, Mr. Halpern, said Dowd. His eyes were wide and alert as they roamed around the room looking at us.
I'm listening.
I'll bet you are, and all your esteemed colleagues as well.
I leaned forward to hear every word. Jules Halpern continued with the real reason for his call. My client wants all possibility of a civil case being brought against him waived.
I rolled my eyes. Halpern wanted to make certain that no one could sue his client in civil court after the criminal court case was concluded. He remembered that O.J. Simpson had been set free in the one court, only to be bankrupted in the other.
Impossible, said Dowd. There's no way in hell that will ever happen. No way.
Listen to me. There is a way, or I wouldn't have broached the subject. If this is done, and if he and I can be convinced of a speedy route to a criminal trial, my client will waive diplomatic immunity. Yes, you heard me correctly. Jeffrey Schaefer wants to prove his innocence in a court of law. He insists on it, in fact. Dowd was shaking his head in disbelief. So was Mike Kersey. His eyes were glazed with astonishment as he glanced across the room at me. None of us could believe what we had just heard from the defense attorney. Jeffrey Schaefer wanted to go to trial.
Conqueror had watched her work High Street in Kensington for nearly 6 weeks. She became his obsession, his fantasy woman, his game piece. He knew everything there was to know about her. He felt, he knew, that he was starting to act like Schaefer. They all were, weren't they? The girl's name was Noreen Anne, and a long time ago, 3 years to be exact, she had travelled to London from Cork, Ireland, with lovely dreams of being a fashion model on the world stage. She was 17 then, nearly 5'10", slender, blonde, and with a face that all the boys and even the older men back home told her was destined for magazine covers, or maybe even the cinema. So what was she doing here on High Street at 1:30 in the morning? She wondered about it as she forced a coquettish smile and occasionally waved a hand at the leering men in their slowly passing cars that made the rounds of High Street, De Vere Gardens, Exhibition Road. They'd thought she was pretty, all right, just not pretty enough for British or American magazine covers, and not good enough, not classy enough, to marry or have as a girlfriend. Well, at least she had a plan, and she thought it was a good one. Noreen Anne had saved nearly 2,000 quid since she began to walk the streets. She thought she needed another 3,000 or so, and then she would head back to Ireland. She'd start a small beauty shop, because she did know the secrets of beauty, and also a lot about the dreams. So, here I am in front of the Kensington Palace Hotel in the meantime, she thought, freezing my fine bum off.
"Excuse me, miss,"
she heard, and turned with a start. She hadn't heard anyone come up on her.
"I couldn't help noticing you standing here. You're an extraordinary beauty, but of course you know that, don't you?"
Noreen Anne felt relief the moment she saw who it was. This one wouldn't hurt her, couldn't if he tried. She could hurt him, if it came to that. He was old, in his late 60s or 70s. He was obscenely fat, and he was seated in a wheelchair. And so she went off. With Conqueror. It was all part of the game. The Americans had promised a speedy route to trial, and the fools had actually delivered. 5 months had passed since the murder of Detective Patsy Hampton. Alex Cross had been shuttling back and forth to Bermuda, but he still had no idea where Christine had disappeared to. Schaefer was out of jail, but on a very short leash. He hadn't played the game once since Hampton's murder. The game of games had been on hold, and it was driving him mad. Now Schaefer sat in his black Jag in the parking lot, directly under the courthouse, feeling hopeful. He was eager to stand trial on the count of aggravated, premeditated murder in the first degree. The rules of play had been established, and he appreciated that. The suppression hearing weeks before was still a vivid memory for him. He'd relished every minute of it. The preliminary hearing was held before the jury selection to determine what evidence would be allowed at the trial. It took place in the spacious chambers of Judge Michael Fesco. The judge set the rules, so in a way, he was the game master. How fabulously droll. How delicious. Schaefer's lawyer, Jules Halpern, argued that Schaefer had been in a therapy session at Dr. Cassidy's home office and therefore had every right to privacy. That privacy was violated. First, Dr. Cassidy refused to let Detective Cross and the other officers come inside. Second, Colonel Schaefer showed his identification to the detective. It proved that he was with the British Embassy and had diplomatic immunity. Cross barged into the therapist's office anyway. Consequently, any evidence obtained, if indeed any evidence was obtained, is the result of unlawful search. Judge Vesco took the rest of the day to consider, then announced his decision the next morning. As I listened to both sides, it seemed to me that the issues were straightforward and not all that unusual in a murder case. Mr. Schaefer does indeed have diplomatic immunity. However, it is my opinion that Detective Cross acted in a reasonable and lawful manner when he went to Dr. Cassidy's apartment. He suspected that a grave crime had been committed. Dr. Cassidy opened the door, allowing Detective Cross plain view of Mr. Schaefer's attire. Colonel Schaefer has insisted all along that his diplomatic immunity denied Detective Cross permission to enter the premises. I am therefore going to allow the prosecution to use the clothing Colonel Schaefer was wearing on the night of the murder, as well as the blood on the carpet outside the apartment door, as evidence. The prosecution may also use any evidence found in the parking garage, both in Detective Hampton's car and in Colonel Schaefer's, Judge Vesco continued. And this was the key part of his ruling. I will not allow evidence found once Detective Cross entered the apartment against the stated wishes of both Colonel Schaefer and Dr. Cassidy. Any and all evidence discovered during the initial or subsequent searches is suppressed and will not be allowed at the trial. The prosecution was also told not to make any reference during the trial to any other uncharged murders that Schaefer was suspected of having committed in Washington. The jury was to understand that Schaefer was under investigation only for the murder of Senior Detective Patricia Hampton. Both the prosecution and the defense claimed victory at the end of the suppression hearing. The stone steps outside the courthouse were swarming with a buzzing, unruly crowd on the morning of the first day. Schaefer's supporters were wearing UK OK buttons and waving crisp new Union Jacks. These wondrous fools made him smile as he clasped both hands high over his head in victory. He enjoyed being a hero immensely. What a glorious time, even if he was a little high and spacey on a few choice pharmaceuticals. Both sides were still predicting slam-dunk victories. Lawyers were such fabulous bullshitters. The press was touting this outrageous charade as the criminal trial of the decade. The media hype, expected and ritualistic, thrilled him anyway. He internalized it as tribute and adulation, his due. He purposely cut quite a dashing figure. He wanted to make an impression on the world. He wore a soft-shouldered, tailored grey suit, a striped bespoke shirt from Bud, and black Oxfords from Loeb's, St. James's. He was photographed 100 times in the first few moments alone. He walked into the courthouse as if in a dream. The most delicious thing of all was that he might lose everything. Courtroom 4 was on the third floor. It was the largest in the building. Closest to the double set of public doors was a gallery that held around 140 spectators. Then came the bar area, where the attorneys' tables were situated. Then the judge's bench, which took up about a quarter of the room. The trial began at 10 in the morning, and it was all a rattle and hum to him. The lead prosecutor was Assistant U.S. Attorney Catherine Marie Fitzgibbon. He already yearned to murder her, and wondered if he possibly could. He wanted Ms. Fitzgibbon's scalp on his belt. She was just 36, Irish Catholic, single, sexy in her tight-arsed way, dedicated to high-minded ideals, like so many others from her island of origin. She favoured dark blue or grey Ann Taylor wardrobes, and wore a ubiquitous tiny gold cross on a gold chain. She was known in the D.C. legal community as the drama queen. Her melodramatic telling of the gory details was meant to win the sympathy of the jury. A worthy opponent, indeed. A worthy prey, as well. Schaefer sat at the defendant's table and tried to concentrate. He listened, watched, felt as he hadn't in a long time. He knew they were all watching him. How could they not? Schaefer sat there observing, but his brain was on fire. His esteemed attorney, Jules Halpern, finally began to speak, and he heard his own name. That piqued his interest all right. He was the star here, wasn't he? Jules Halpern was little more than 5'4", but he cut quite a powerful figure in a court of law. His hair was dyed jet black and slicked back tightly against his scalp. His suit was from a British tailor, just like Schaefer's. Schaefer thought, rather uncharitably, he supposed, dress British,